The F-22 Raptor is one of America's premier fighter aircraft. The nation's first fifth-generation, multi-purpose fighter aircraft was designed to carry the United States into the 21st century and triumph over any near-peer competitor. However, despite its advanced technologies and capabilities, the plane was doomed to failure right from the start due to a combination of factors, including competing projects and no enemies to fight. And perhaps worst of all for the plane's manufacturer Lockheed Martin, it was never exported to foreign countries like other aircraft have been when newer ones come online for the US military. Here are the reasons why it failed. First and foremost, despite its reputation, the F-22 is still the world's premier air superiority fighter aircraft. American engineers designed it to locate, engage, and destroy enemy aircraft before those pilots even knew they were being targeted. The capability of the F-22 in the air-to-air domain was tested in the early 2000s, when it took out hundreds of aircraft in simulated kills while suffering just one loss of its own. Because of this air-to-air dominance, the F-22 focuses primarily on this capability, and its ground attack mission set is only secondary. This is evidenced by the fact that the aircraft did not perform its first combat missions until 2014 against ISIS in Iraq and Syria. While this probably seemed like a waste of resources, with the advanced air defense systems given to the Syrians by Russia, the US needed to ensure that the Syrian military would not shoot down their aircraft since the US had carried out strikes against them in the past. Compared to newer aircraft like the F-35, the Raptor still retains its primary role as the main tool the United States uses to obtain and maintain air dominance over the enemy. The F-35, for example, was designed to meet the needs of all the services, and this included creating a model to take off vertically from ships and with a primary focus on ground attack. Though the F-35 is a fifth-generation fighter with excellent stealth capabilities, it would never compare to how well the Raptor can perform in aerial combat, since America didn't design it for that. However, unlike the F-35, the Raptor from the beginning was never designed nor intended to be produced as an export aircraft. This is because during the 1980s, when the aircraft was first being designed, the US wanted to have the edge over any aircraft China or Russia could throw at it. As a result, the advanced stealth capabilities like the composites, radars, electronics, and various avionics, including computer software and electronic warfare suites, were all classified as top secret. The military intended that only the US and specifically only the Air Force would be the ones to operate this aircraft. Because of this, equipment like the communication suites, radars, and software installed on board was the most advanced and capable in the US arsenal. As is typical for aircraft with foreign military sales in mind, systems like these are purposefully left out of the frame to be installed in the country of sale with their own equipment, or produced with a less capable version that still allows interoperability. Even if the military designed the F-22 with export in mind, that would all change in 1998, when Congress made it a law to forever ban the sale of the Raptor to any foreign country. The amendment was passed as part of the 1998 Defense Authorization Act and was designed to protect these critical technologies from anyone else. However, codifying this into law was probably not necessary anyway, because of many factors that would have precluded the United States from exporting the aircraft. One of the primary reasons that the military could not have exported the aircraft was the cost. During the 1980s, the F-22 was first imagined. The Air Force intended to buy 750 of these aircraft. However, as cost overruns continued, this number was revised to 650, and then 381. In 2009, the Secretary of Defense authorized that just 195 of these aircraft would be procured and no more. The government reduced these numbers dramatically due to the enormous cost overruns that plagued the project, very similar to what was happening with the F-35. In the beginning, the Air Force estimated that the industry could produce the planes at the cost of just $120 million per aircraft, adjusted for inflation, of course. However, as development slowed and testing came to a halt, the aircraft would eventually come out with a price tag of almost $400 million per aircraft. Accounting for inflation and the maintenance costs over the lifespan of the aircraft, each Raptor is estimated to cost a whopping $700 million. There are several reasons why the aircraft costs so much, which would exclude it as a prime candidate for foreign sales, since these aircraft must usually be cheap and quick to manufacture. The F-22 was neither of those. Development for the plane began in 1986, when the US government awarded the contract to start production. The testing and design phase lasted through the 1990s, and production started in the early 2000s. The first operational aircraft was delivered to the Air Force in 2005, meaning that the time from conception to the first operational flight was almost 20 years. With such a long lead time, the rest of the defense industry developed around it, while the design languished on the drawing board. Citing the Air Force's 2017 feasibility study, the service noted that when the Raptor was first designed, the Air Force intended to combat enemies in a contested air environment. A contested air environment would mean the aircraft would encounter things such as enemy fighters and air defense missile batteries. However, as the report has noted, the world has dramatically changed since the Raptor first came out. The Air Force now assesses that by the time it would take to retool the manufacturing base for a potential export model, the Raptor would be facing highly contested airspaces. This means that the future operating environment the Raptor would face had the Air Force and Congress decided to start production in 2017 would be too fraught with danger to maintain the edge it had before. With the proliferation of advanced air defense radars and missiles across the world, as well as new fighter aircraft designed to go toe-to-toe with the F-22, as well as an increase in the cyber warfare domain, the threats to the F-22 would become so much as to question its feasibility on the battlefield. As a result, the Air Force warned that restarting production for an aircraft for sale might mean that they will be obsolete when these aircraft are delivered anyway. However, simply telling the aviation industry that Congress had the money and a buyer for new Raptors to be exported was not feasible. One of the main reasons was the production of the B-21 stealth bomber and ongoing projects to develop the F-35. Because the F-22 took so long to design and produce, the F-35 was ordered into existence beginning in the early 1990s to cut down on costs associated with future aircraft development for all the services. While most of the time the program was just in its infancy, after the F-22 started to roll off the production line, the F-35 program started to take off. In addition, the aerospace industry needed resources to produce the B-21 bomber. Therefore, from the early 2000s to about 2010, three major aircraft programs were competing for funding. During this time, the United States was also experiencing the worst recession in decades and the troop drawdown from Iraq. Because of this, the defense budget would be carefully scrutinized to prevent any costs not deemed absolutely necessary. Because of this limited funding, Congress, through the Department of Defense, had to make some tough decisions. They could continue producing the additional several hundred F-22s or pour money into the two other programs. However, due to political and operational considerations to be discussed later on, the decision was made to curtail the production to just 195 aircraft and invest those funds elsewhere. Since Congress was now investing funds into the B-21 and F-35, companies like Lockheed Martin, Boeing, Northrop Grumman, and others had to retool and refocus their efforts on these developing projects since they are private companies not going to work for free. Because these companies had to refocus their efforts, the tooling and supply chain for the F-22 began to deteriorate. Since the F-22 is so state-of-the-art, it required brand new tools to be created to produce it. The Air Force estimated that the industry used over 50,000 tools to make the aircraft, with many of them being newly designed. Additionally, these tools produced another estimated 90,000 unique parts to build the plane from the ground up. With production now shifting to other aircraft, the aerospace industry did not have the resources to produce all of the aircraft simultaneously. Another factor that the aerospace industry lacked that would preclude building export models was the lack of knowledge. According to a study published by the RAND Corporation in 2010, they estimated that if the production did not resume within 3 years, the aerospace industry would lose 100% of its knowledge in building the aircraft. In 2017, the Air Force produced their own study that contradicted those claims, but still painted a grim picture. The Air Force estimated that of the 40 different companies involved in making the F-22, at least half of them would require retraining. At the cost of over $30 million per company, simply retraining the industry to build the aircraft would cost almost $1 billion. However, the Air Force acknowledged that this was a conservative estimate and that the actual cost could be much higher. The Air Force's own study estimated the total cost to rebuild the program to be at least $10 billion just from what equipment and parts were available. However, that number is slightly flawed since the Air Force admitted that the export version of the F-22 was never designed, nor were any plans drawn up for how it would look. The figures presented were simply for restarting production for US consumption and not for foreign countries. Developing a brand new aircraft from the ground up could see similar costs as before and preclude any cost savings from building new aircraft, which the nation's air service estimated could be brought down to $216 million per plane. Building a new export model of the F-22 also did not factor in the international support the US would need to do it. After all, if the aircraft is designed for foreign use, it is essential that the end users of the plane also get a say in its design to meet their own needs, so that the end product is not just an American model that they think they need. Like with the F-35, multiple countries have invested from the beginning. However, even if the export model were approved and designed, its market would have been somewhat limited. Despite the 1998 ban on allowing foreign sales of the F-22, that did not stop the governments of Japan, Australia, and Israel from making repeated requests at buying some. Beginning around the mid-2000s, these countries were interested in a small yet competent fleet of aircraft, and their primary motivation was because the F-35 program was taking too long. Additionally, the F-22 had years of data and thousands of flight hours of safe operations testifying to its capabilities. With the F-35 still not being operational yet at the time, these countries wanted an immediate replacement for their aging aircraft. However, despite repeated calls for selling it, the US remained steadfast in not producing or even designing an export model. As a result, these countries would eventually lose interest and invest their time and money into perfecting the F-35. Ultimately, these countries became customers of the F-35 program and operate them today instead of the F-22. Therefore, even if the US had designed an export model, it would have come too late to garner any buyers in the international market. In addition to the actual costs of restarting the program, do you remember those political costs we mentioned earlier? One of the main reasons that doomed the F-22 from future production and killed the chance of any foreign sales was, at the time, it was an aircraft without an enemy. When it came out in 2005, it had already missed both invasions of Iraq and faced no conventional enemy on the battlefield. The Air Force recognized this and did not let it participate in ground combat until the 2014 Syrian strikes. Because it was an aircraft with no enemy to fight and competitors lagging years behind it, it was decided there would only ever be 195 of the aircraft. The political decision to cancel the aircraft, despite the Air Force stating that it still needed more, came down to the Secretary of Defense. At the time, the SecDef said that the US had only one near-peer competitor now, China, and that Russia was still years behind in developing an aircraft that could come close to touching it. If that were not enough, more Raptors did not have the support of the President either, who stated that he would veto the 2010 defense budget if it included funding for any more Raptors. Therefore, due to high costs, no intention to involve foreign partners, no mission at the time, and political wrangling, the F-22 would be forever destined to serve in a US military capacity only.